Recording.
All right, today's January 24th, 2021, and we're continuing our discussion on the Desiderata Extinctionati. Our agenda today is how do you free a cage chimp that's been born and bred in captivity? And yeah, let's get it started. Whoever, this is going to be a good topic.
So we're going to talk about us.
Yeah. I think you posted, if you haven't, for those watching the video, if you haven't watched the post on the chimp named Lucy, who was raised by, who was raised by humans. And then, so it's a good video if you guys want to watch it.
Yeah, it's kind of a tragic story. There's also a Radiolab podcast that's on it. That's quite interesting. Yeah, the whole premise is just that we are just kind of domesticated chimps in captivity. And it isn't working out. I mean, our zoo, where we've caged ourselves, the urban jungle, is not really a human environment. And no one will really admit it. They're all just popping pills and committing suicide and dreadfully unhappy. But if you cage animals like chimps, they pace up and down and do psychotic behaviors. And I think that that's what most people are doing. They're doing repetitive behaviors. I mean, going into work on a 9-to-5 basis is a repetitive psychotic behavior. So it's much akin to an animal pacing up and down its cage. But we refuse to recognize it. And we say that there's some major program on board where we're all heading for the stars, but it's kind of a millennial fantasy and we're heading for destruction, obviously. So the question is, how do we get out of this urban trap and the civilization trap and back again? And yeah. So what do you guys think? I definitely have opinions on it. I'll share them after you, but go for it.
Oh, really?
Here, there's something that Sophie and I were talking about, which is a little bit to one side, but I think it makes a comment. Sophie was talking about the psoas muscle, and which is, you said, was the largest muscle in the human body, and there was a certain technique for releasing tension in that, and that this is connected, didn't you say, to the reptilian level of the brains? And anyway, just to cut it short, I was looking at the video and that Sophie sent, and the fellow was introducing it, and he said there are only two kinds of animals that build up tension in this muscle and can't release it. One is zoo animals and the other is human beings. And I immediately started to think about down Lord Who lines about, well, yeah, I mean, look at it, it's, we probably are zoo animals. You know, I think the basis of the tension buildup was that you can't express your fight business in response to challenges. So you sort of freeze, as I understand it, and this tension remains caught up in that muscle system in your body. So if you do want to add something to that.
Yes, because I was witness, because in my past life, I used to work in labor wards and I was an obstetrician and I used to work with midwives, and so I delivered a lot of babies, and I noticed that very often I'd see some women after the baby would be born that would just suddenly, out of pure exhaustion and after a lot of stress, start to tremble and shake a lot. You know, they would have their legs literally like this, you know, like you've seen some humans sometimes like that after a big fear that cannot be, that, you know, that they cannot control. But a lot of people don't tremble, but you see that in certain extreme circumstances. And that exercise that we were talking about, which is called trauma releasing exercise, that has been experimented in refugee camps to help people who have been faced with extraordinary circumstances, horrible experiences, to teach them again what the animal in them would do if they had been faced with that, which is to allow that muscle we're talking about, the psoas muscle, to relax, and also because it hadn't relaxed, to let that tension go out by allowing the sort of trembling of the limbs, of the lower limbs mostly. And it's amazing. It's a really a proof of our domestication, because I mean we are not allowed to run away. When we see, for example, I don't know, like I hate to go into supermarkets and big places because they scare the shit out of me because it's a big crowd. And I'm probably quite primitive that way because I don't want to be surrounded with. So I often felt as a child like running away from it. But I was told very young, you better follow me and that's it, you know. So I had to keep this kind of, oh, I hate this place. But, you know, I had to do it. And that must be multiplied by a myriad of experiences like that that stopped me from running away from things that were absolutely horrible, like big cities and traffic and all that, you know. So imagine people who are caged in a terrible life. And, you know, anyway, that's what I have to say. I leave you to talk about this now.
So, Sophie, where does the muscle run exactly? What's the anatomy? You're mute.
You're muted.
Are you still mute? Sophie, you're muted.
Sorry. It's a very long muscle that's attached on your lower part of your spine that goes down the back of your abdomen and attaches on the upper part of the, on the low part of the hip. And it's connected to the lower limbs. So it's a very, very long, I'll show it to you in a minute because I've got my gray anatomy here. If you like, I'll get it.
Did you say soleus muscle?
P-S-O-A-S. P-S-O-A-S. Soas.
Okay.
Yeah. Okay. Yeah. I'll send you the link later on.
Where's the sciatic nerve go in relation to it? You're muted.
They're still muted.
It's actually very close. At the lower part of the psoas. Yeah, it's very, very close. I'll get it now in a minute because I'm not used to going that book because I didn't study in that one. So it's muscle. I get this picture for you. I'm still in books for medicine. I don't look much at things online. No. Hands. There, we're getting there. Oh, those drawings are bad.
Sophie, do you think it's the same muscle that in a death rattle? Do you think that's maybe what happens with the death rattle?
Maybe. It's a muscle that's involved mostly in getting you in the position of running away. It contracts to give you the power to just jump around, go, like, you know, get, oh, you know, when you're like this and you have to run. So it contracts inside.
It's the muscle that makes dinosaur fossils arch up, right? You know, not Stegosaurus, Archaeopteryx. Like Archaeopteryx and those little lizards, they all have a curved back. And the reason
Comparative, I've got it there, 236, at comparative anatomy. I didn't study that very much, so I don't know much about the animal's muscles. There's no good drawing of it in my book. I don't know why they do. People are not interested in that muscle. People who are interested in that muscle are people who do physiotherapy or things like that, but anatomy, I don't know. There's no drawings in my book of it, and I don't have any other one here, but I should have. I'll get something while we're talking.
We can find links afterwards and just post them.
Sophie, I think near the beginning of that video, didn't he show a frame
that's
showing
right.
that muscle?
Just get
a screenshot.
It's very long. It goes from about the middle of your the lower third of your spine. And it goes behind the abdomen and it attaches itself on the upper part of the inner hip, inside, not outside, but it's got branches that it's attached. It's got very wide attachments on different parts of your hip, so that it's an extremely powerful muscle. But it's connected to structures in the abdomen, which means that the neurotransmitters that are made there are very quick to arrive in that muscle. And so you've got this kind of emergency response that muscle gives.
So it's basically a startle reflex. You can just leap.
Yeah.
And is that why people get sciatic pressure?
No, we don't know, because you see there's so many, there's the spine things for the sciatica, the spine theories, because the discs and the fact that we spend a lot of time sitting down and not crouched down and not sitting on the floor. But there's also, yes, the position, the tension of that muscle can cause a bad position of the spine. So you can also... all that creates inflammation, and the sciatic nerve is very close. So all these things are connected. You can't just say it's one thing. It's all a network of different factors, you know. Mm.
Yeah. So, like, does everybody remember the exercise that I gave you for relaxation? That sitting with your spine straight and doing an inventory like that is very useful.
I've got another one.
So I did want to say one thing on about this is that it's very easy to get into coping mechanisms. Everybody wants to help, and everybody comes with a little problem, and they try and cope. It's not really the business we probably want to be in. Our business is more to make people have a breakdown. So there's a kind of an industry of people trying to help people to cope and hold it together. This isn't the work of holding it together. This is the work of falling apart.
I know. But what's interesting, you see, is it's just a show, really. I know those exercises are designed for treating trauma, basically. And I know that that's not the root cause. But what I mean is that it's why I was talking about that with Gary is that it's also an amazing tool to have on the side. But it shows you. It's just a near living experiment. If you ever you do it yourself to see how much we are domesticated. Because if this muscle was released naturally as you go, you wouldn't have these problems, you see. So it is a living proof of what we're talking about.
Yeah, I see that point, that just the mere fact that only two types of animals have that stress, zoo animals and us, means that we are in severe stress. And at work, I noticed that too. Like, there's a lot of coping techniques, you know, attend this meditation class, bring your dog to work so that you learn to cope. But to me, why don't they remove the causes of the stress instead of, giving us this coping mechanisms, meditation, consciousness, or awareness, or something like that? Sorry.
Yeah, no, you're making exactly the point I want to make, is that we need to end the war, not find ways to patch people up and send them back into the front lines, which are what most of these techniques are for. So it's one thing to help people out. I mean, the way to actually make progress is tension and relief. But there's such a big industry. Everybody feels that, particularly from a mammalian brain point of view, is that you want to help, people are suffering and you want to help, but you're helping people survive the concentration camp. And really, if you're in Auschwitz, you want people's breaking point. You want them to reach the breaking point. You don't want them to be able to cope. It's dysfunctional to make a chimp able to cope with the zoo. So it's only when the people break down that you can have a breakthrough, and we can get somewhere with the zoo in general. But if everybody can survive the zoo and find ways to actually cope, then they will just ramp up the pressure, and we'll never get rid of the system. So we're kind of on a longer term bent, and that's freeing people from the zoo. Not quite making them able to cope with the zoo, because the shelves are just groaning with coping, self-help books. There's if you want a coping mechanism, you can look at fine selections of wines. You can look at good food. Everybody is doing escapes. The media survives because everybody's using it to escape. They come home from a 9-to-5 job, collapse into a sofa so they can watch TV, and that's just basically their only coping mechanism. So everybody is doing these coping mechanisms. It's one of the first things in a revolution. If you see that battle for Algiers, one of the interesting things about it is the very first move. If you look at, in contrast to something like Roger Hallam, not to pick on him terribly, but he's doing mobilization. He's not doing organization. He's not really organizing a rebellion. He's just gathering people up to basically protest, which is really reinforces the system, reinforces the power of the government. But what they did in the Battle of Algiers on day one was they went around all the streets and they took away people's alcohol. They beat up people that used drugs. They went around taking away everybody's coping mechanisms. That's step one in a revolution. So basically all these new age things and yoga things and all these nice things are actually counter-revolutionary and very, very dangerous now because it looks like the Arctic is melting and the climate is destabilizing. And if you are going around making people feel okay at this point, then really it's wrong from a number of angles. It's wrong if there really is no hope and there's nothing we can do. It seems to me morally bankrupt to just dope people out. On the Titanic, I don't think you have a right, say if you were the captain, to say, yeah, what we'll do is we'll just drug everybody's drinks. We'll give out free champagne, just drug them, and everybody will be asleep when the Titanic goes down. I think that is abhorrent. You have a right, kind of like McPherson says, to tell people the Titanic's going down and give them their last moments lucid, basically. Otherwise, what the hell is consciousness for if you don't get to face death consciously? So it's kind of unconscionable in my view that there's so much excuse for our system and so much, so many band-aids that are basically, you know, farmed out in the mistaken belief that people are being kind. I don't believe you should be, you know, giving people morphine on the battlefield because of what you say in the Desiderata, that basically the meaning of it all is to achieve ataraxia and a meaningful death.
But so, can I add something to what you're saying?
Yeah.
I think that what Gary was talking about, those type of exercises, are, I wouldn't put them under the self-help thing, because they don't help you to cope with the situation. They release attention. That's it. They don't, attention that has accumulated so that you can use your physical and ability. It's body exercise. You can be reading a book while you're doing them. Do you know what I mean? It has nothing to do with your mental state. It's purely physical. And I think that those types of things are not only a demonstration of what we're talking about with domestication, but they can be a tool for certain people, traumatized people, extremely traumatized people in the ranks of people who are resisting, even who haven't had enough release. There's your muscle now. I found a picture. I don't know if you can see that. It's the red muscle.
Oh, yeah.
You see?
Yeah,
it's very internal.
I think Risa posted in the notes, posted a Wikipedia.
Oh, that's perfect. Okay.
I put the video in the link to Sophie's video. It shows the muscle right at the very beginning as well. I don't know if that is it showing up for you there.
Yeah. So.
Yeah.
It is. So.
Okay.
Yeah. No, absolutely agree with you. But you need strength of physical strength and strength of mind. But I was just adding a note of caution that the fact is we're not trying to stop people breaking down. The idea is really like a capacitor to increase your capacity to have a realizational experience or a peak moment. The more capacity you can endure, almost like a capacity, the more, you know, coulombs it can take, the more charge it can take, the higher supercapacitor, the charge that a supercapacitor can carry is analogous to how much your brain can carry in terms of just sheer awakening. So in order to become a bigger and stronger capacitor with more charge, yeah, these are all valid. But as long as we don't forget that they're not designed to stop you from actually breaking down. The breakdown is psychosis. And so what the psychiatric profession in that is pulling people back from psychosis. And I think we should be doing the opposite. We should be pushing people deeper into it. Basically, if the you see, we're in a special situation because we've caged ourselves. So it's not quite analogous to the zoo. Because we're in self-domestication, the system only works because the animals contribute to their domestication. And so they need to be broken from that because they need to break down and stop supporting it. Because the reason the system persists is because everybody does their job. Everybody copes. Everybody contributes. Nobody will resist. And so they're obedient to the system that is destroying us. So the way to get there is to, A, build up people's capacity, but also to make sure that they reach that epiphany where they stop supporting. And you only do that from a breakdown. People, it's not a decision where you wake up one day and say, oh, I'm going to stop supporting the system. It's not that at all. That's just that part of your brain that is making those decisions is the problem part. So that's your alien cortex that wakes up and makes a decision saying, I'm not going to be an alien cortex today. It's like, I'll tell you that's horseshit. Your alien cortex is going to be an alien cortex. So it's kind of insane to say that.
But what if you've been like that? Make it as far as you remember as a child, that you've always been like that, that you don't make a decision, but you've always felt that you wanted to just knock it down or not be part of it.
Yeah, that's a good basis for starting the journey. But you can't beat the system, right? You can't rebel against the system and beat it, because part of the system's inside. It's all about the alien cortex. So you have to fight the alien cortex externally, the meta-alien cortex, which is causing all the problems. But you have an alien cortex internally. So the problem with a lot of these movements is kind of like XR. It's like, yeah, you go and beat the evil alien cortex and then defeat the whole world. And then you put, you know, citizens' assemblies. And what are they? They're assemblies of alien cortexes, the very thing that you just got rid of. So that's why all these utopian ideals and revolutions, and they never work because they're all plots of the alien cortex. The alien cortex is the villain. It's getting rid of the alien cortex. And the only way to
Hugh,
do
can
that,
I stop you there?
Break it. Yeah, yeah.
Yeah, just before you get too far away from it, when you were talking about the alien cortex waking up in the morning and, you know, sort of saying, well, I'm going to do away with myself kind of thing, which comes back to the same spiritual nexus question, problem. It's the prime spiritual problem is that here I am setting out on my journey to enlightenment, so to speak. I don't even know what that is. I'm told that this is something. I believe that, and I'm told you've got to go through this process of the eupsychosis somehow or another, but it's not something that you can decide to do, and you're in this fix where you've got to do something that you can't do or that you can't decide to do, but it still must happen. And you're completely caught out by this. There's no path of conventional action that's going to lead you to that eupsychosis. I don't know where you're getting to is what you do, fight the meta-alien cortex to set up the circumstances whereby the eupsychosis is forced upon you by external circumstances
the alien cortex is self-destructive. It's going to destroy us no matter what. So with that perception that we're going to be destroyed, there's a kind of a devious out. And that's basically, you can destroy it yourself early in order to avoid getting destroyed. it's really convoluted, but that's the essence of it is since we're heading for self-destruction, there is no out. The alien cortex will destroy us. It's basically, it's part of the equation. You just run, it's like a computer program. You run it to completion and it halts. It halts the whole world. It halts us as a species. It'll halt everything. So you say, well, what's the way out? Well, it just so happens that our alien cortexes are just clever enough to defeat themselves. So in out of fear of dying, you say, well, there is one kind of death, but you know, you kind of, you have to die to get there. So it's kind of like, it's a rebellion because it's kind of like the rebellion of the rest of the brain against the alien cortex. And the reprieve, though you don't want to dwell on this too much, is that it even saves the alien cortex, because the alien cortex can be saved as long as basically it's crushed. So once it's crushed, then it becomes more of a servant. And then basically you have a kind of happy household into it. So we could all survive if we could get there. So the really getting back to the thing about domesticated chimps is we are like a chimp in one way, but in terms of domestication and captivity, but we're different in another way, and that's we have self-perception. So we can do what, say, Lucy could never do, and that's to know that we are incarcerated. So Lucy could never know that the difference between the wild and domestication. But we are intelligent enough to know and see our own domestication, and through that do the complete Klein bottle sort of mathematics of saying, well, I don't want to die, so I'm going to kill myself.
Have we already done it in a way? Because, how can I put it? Are we kind of doing it subconsciously? When you look at the trajectory of the world at the moment, it's going to go down the default pathway to catastrophe, because there's not going to be any kind of concerted effort to do anything about it. The addiction to the way things, to business as usual, is just going ahead. But has that been, is that kind of inevitability been a kind of a subconscious decision on the part of humanity to choose that pathway? You know, in other words, at some deeper level, have we already chosen to sabotage this the meta alien cortex in order to create our
not yet. So what it's doing is it's not that it doesn't, it's the struggle that's causing us to go extinct. So it's ironically, all the things that people are doing, all the struggle against climate change, all the activism, all the geoengineering, all the efforts people are doing to stop, to that they think is helpful, is actually the problem. So it's really that we are active and we're struggling against our demise that is causing our demise. So now you have to have a certain level
this
of attention.
This is what I'm questioning. How much are we actually struggling against our demise?
Oh, we're struggling desperately. We're desperately. That's what the whole thing is. That's what everybody's doing, running around like crazy ass people. They're fighting and fighting and fighting. They won't surrender. And that's the problem. That's why we're going to go extinct, because nobody will give up.
We're only seen to be fighting and fighting to maintain the same pathway, which is the fastest way to go extinct.
No, we're not fighting to do the same pathway. So think about it. On the one side, there are people that are sort of green and climate aware and, very conscious of the fact that the ecology is going down. Let's call them the left. And they're fighting to save the planet. So they're fighting for their ego. Their ego is the size of a planet. And then you look at people like Big Oil and stuff like that. It's like they're also fighting for their ego. They're fighting for their conservatism and their lifestyle. So if you take, for instance, a recent example, like Donald Trump is fighting for his ego as hard as anybody on, you know, say, Monbiot or, you know, Michael Moore or somebody like that. They're fighting for their ego. It's just their ego is democracy and all this collection of ideas that they have. It's just two collections of ideas, and what holds those collections of ideas together is a nexus of ego. So while everybody fights for their little ego, that's it. We're fucked by almost a magic combination and kind of a magical cross-canceling checkmate. It's only if one side gave up. So if any side gave up, if any side would be allow the other one to win, then we would be saved, because basically in winning, the other side would undo themselves. So in other words, think of it like this. If Donald Trump and conservatives and the right wing woke up and had an epiphany one day and said, look, we're all fucked. We're all fucked. It doesn't matter. Our side's not going to win. We're not going to preserve our lifestyle. We're not going to keep our faith and our identity and all of that. We're fucked. So let's just be fucked early. We listen to Lord Hugh and we just do that. And we just say, okay, you win. Okay, all you identity politics, feminist, you know, debagging, wokeism heroes, social justice warriors, you win. There you go. You have total power. Do your damnedest. And they'd go, yay, we all win. And then they'd find they're in exactly the same position. Citizens' assemblies and stuff are not going to solve anything. Citizens' assemblies would be instantly conservatives as soon as you put them in the office of Boris Johnson or whatever. Once you handed over Boris Johnson's problems to a citizens' assembly, they would deal with them in exactly the same way. That's not the issue. So basically, but if any one side broke symmetry, that symmetry breaking then would mean that they would actually, basically break out of this homeostasis. So homeostasis is the problem. We're stuck in homeostasis because this side is leaning from the left and this side is leaning from the right. So they're basically in deadlock, in equilibrium. And that's the nature of the alien cortex. It's divided against itself. So it's kind of like a house divided cannot stand. Well, no, unfortunately, a house divided against itself stands perfectly, kind of like a house of cards. So basically, it leans up against each other. But if you took one side of the house of cards away, the house of cards would collapse and there would be progress, right? But we're self-defeating in the fact that we are contradictory. And that's the alien cortex is fundamentally contradictory. It's like looking at itself in a mirror. So if you took the mirror away, it could make progress. But
yeah, so basically what you're saying is it's got to create the circumstances where one side of it can win the arm wrestle against itself. Otherwise, you're just fixed.
So that's in the meta arena. But it same applies because it's a kind of a hologram of itself. It's self-similar all the way down. So it same applies to you. If you just give up the struggle and say, well, this is just fucking impossible. This is an impossible scheme. I'm just going to kill myself. You say, perfect. Except for the rule in the Desiderata Extinctionati that you're not allowed to harm yourself physically. You know, well, fuck, it's going to be difficult.
No, but I mean, but this just brings us back to what I was complaining bitterly about a moment ago. Was I can't make that decision because it's just part of I'm artificially dividing my alien cortex in two, and one half is making that decision and the other half's not. It's we've still got this equal this thing that can't defeat itself.
Yeah, but
you know, as long as because you've got to ask what
it has to be brought to the end of its tether. You see, what everybody's trying to do is trying to short circuit it and trying to be clever. You see, like Roger Hallam, what he's trying to do with Extinction Rebellion is he's trying to get round the obstructive left and mobilize everybody and, you know, get out of his fate. He realizes that we're heading for a cliff, but he's going to try and organize and push and do all these extra impetus movements, these actions, these forced actions to try and get a different outcome. But, you know, really, that's the problem. That's not the solution. The thing is to just capitulate, to absolutely capitulate. So nobody will give up. Nobody will surrender. And that's the problem. If we all surrendered, it would be fine.
But this is, I guess what I'm trying to get to all the time here is that this capitulation is something that simply needs to occur. It's not something you can do.
No, not quite.
I mean, I know you've said you can set up the external circumstances to make it come back. In other words, you can affect the meta-alien cortex and set up an outcome that then affects individual alien cortexes. And so that's a way around. But from within yourself, you in a sense, you're powerless.
You have to work out the whole argument to the end. So what a lot of people are doing...
Yeah, but you see, you're one part of your brain. Everything, how can I put it? Even subconsciously, like every part of your brain has access to all of the knowledge and information that every other part of it has. Just because you don't have conscious access to all those separate parts doesn't mean that those separate parts aren't just as clever as the bit that you think you are.
Exactly.
And, you know, so you think you've got a bit of a workaround here, but don't forget that underneath there that you don't consciously know about, it knows that
coming. There is no workaround. There's no workaround. You see, what Roger Hallam is doing is he thinks there's a workaround. He thinks, you can get around the anarchists, you can get around the obstructive left. We have to do something and break this kind of, you know, left-wing self-defeating thing. It's the same with you internally. Is just as you say, you have all these unconscious parts that are going to have their say. You have to work them out. The logic, you have to do the debate all the way to the end. The thing that Roger Hallam's trying to avoid with XR is trying to not have the debate. Let's not think, just act. And you say, no, you have to basically go through this crucible. This is the essence of alchemy, is that basically through the turmoil in this crucible, you've got to boil each one of these elements down. Now, it was very systematic when the alchemists did it, but we've kind of lost a lot of that knowledge. So, but you have to keep boiling the arguments inside you. So it's more like, think of it like reflection. So one of the ways to do this is to keep on thinking these questions through and arguing with yourself until basically you snap. You see, there is no answer. It does not compute. But you have to do it like, in essence, like a court case. You know, I always thought that mural that I put up, I don't know why nobody upvotes those, but I put this absolute gem up of Kairos and the pharaohs, this mural of the pharaohs weighing, of the priest weighing the pharaoh's heart against a feather. So you have to do that weighing of your heart against the feather. It's in a process. And basically, when the end result of that process is liberation, because there is no answer. You basically just exhaust yourself in the computation. So basically, you say the world does not compute. What the alien cortex is trying to do is fundamentally impossible. And it was proved mathematically by Turing and Gödel. So the program that the alien cortex is on. So essentially, it's got a name. It was the Hilbert program. But the Hilbert program has no solution. And that's what you need to get to, that epiphany. So as a society, we went through that exercise. We had the Hilbert program, and Gödel and Turing proved that we are on a fool's errand. Our whole society, our civilization is on a fool's errand. But we couldn't do that. We couldn't stop there. Everybody just ran on and with the computer and stuff because of what you said, that every single voice has to be heard and answered. You have to go in around all the houses. See, what we couldn't stop at the Hilbert program as a society because there were millions and millions of other voices that still needed to have their input and be answered.
So when you think
group of intellectuals that got it.
Yeah, I'm just, you know, when you reach that point that you realize that you haven't got anything else. You can't raise any other objection, and you're kind of stuck.
That's why the court case is such a good analogy, and the mural, that Egyptian mural, is so profound. Because if you've ever been in a court case, in a really grueling kind of deadlock court case, it goes on and grinds, and you bring forth this and you bring forth that. And it basically, you know, they say the wheels of justice move slow, but they grind exceedingly fine. If you've ever been in one of those court cases and seen them grind exceedingly fine, basically, eventually, everybody's exhausted. And, you know, what happens in those situations is our society does a fudge. The judge just goes, okay, there is no solution, and basically either just divides the baby like Solomon, or otherwise just says, fuck it, this one wins. I just like the look of this guy. It's some bizarre thing. A society can't have the fact that basically court cases are aren't resolvable. Every single court case is resolved by a fudge where essentially the judge just cheats. But if you brought all the evidence of every single person's story throughout history and all the prior history of this universe and brought it to some court case, basically the court case couldn't be resolved. And we can't have that in our society. So we just fuck it up and just we just do a fudge and say like, ah, fuck, this one wins. And just so we can carry on. But you can't do that to yourself. You have to get to the stage where every voice has been heard, every bit of evidence and every argument has been made to the court. And then there's no resolution, and then snap. Very dramatic day when that happens. But it only happens if you do the court case. Most people are trying to stay out of court. They're trying to, you know, find reasons to sit on the couch, drink themselves away. So they don't have to do the court case. So that's a lot
of
coping mechanism. People doing the trial. They're not doing the trial. You can do the trial. You can't deliver the verdict or demand that it gets there, but you can do the trial all the time.
Yeah.
Does that make sense?
I
follow you, but there, when you come to doing the trial, can you elaborate on that, please?
So it can be done as an exercise just by asking, who am I? Just asking the hard, naive, fundamental questions is like, what is life all about? What is this? If we all go extinct now, if we get a blue ocean event, we all die miserably and this, you know, turns into Venus, you say, then what is it about? Then what does it matter? Does anything matter? Does it matter that I was here? Does it matter that I was here now and saw? Is there some meaning to it? Those kind of questions. Say, what am I fundamentally in? I mean, after we all gone, there's not a single molecule that's destroyed. They'll just be rearranged. So what the fuck was going on? How did we get assembled into this, you know, chinops, you know, carbon, hydrogen, nitrogen, oxygen, phosphor, and sulfur? How do we get this bag that got animated by electricity? What was that? What was it all about? Does it matter then? Does it really matter that, like, Michael Mann is on a, you know, never going to get his thing with human agency? We passed the point of human agency in the climate struggle. So, you know, then say, then what? You know, then what? Those questions. And so basically, but it has to be done with with a kind of desperation.
Yes, thank you.
You've only got a limited amount of time. I mean, if Guy McPherson's right, you've got until 2024 to sort this out.
And that's the crux.
Too much time sitting in front of the TV.
And that's the crux of the problem, is that we're comfortable. There's no desperation in most people's lives. Well, at least
no, it's
in the little bubble that I'm living in.
No, it's quiet desperation. My dad always used to like to say that, you know, we live a life of quiet desperation. Is it? It always used to fascinate him that there's nothing you can rail about or go and punch something about. Or it's just a quiet. Everybody feels it. It's quiet desperation. It's just is nothing ever gets done. The housework never gets done. The bills never get paid. This creeping accounting coming after you, where the taxman and the policeman and the you know all these exes and past history is just crawling towards you all the time.
I see. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. You just and there's nothing you can do. You can't shoot them all down. You can't outrun them. You just live in this quiet desperation. Every day is a kind of a lie and a deflection, and just trying to get by. Just trying to pay the bills, dude. Nothing going on but the rent. So that's quiet struggle is what everybody's doing. And so they're looking for relief from that struggle. But relief from the struggle really comes in ramping it up until you're broken. And it's only, you know, it really is suicide. It really is. You just, while you think you can cope and you struggle, it'll just go on forever. It's only when you say, fuck it, I give up, then you have an epiphany. But you have to be very careful because everybody gives up at some stage, and what they usually do is go one step too far. They pick up a gun and blow their brains out. You say, no, you almost got it. Apart from that bit, shouldn't have done the blow your brains out bit. You see, do you understand that if you get to the point where you go, it's done so often, but we don't see it. In the movie Trading Places, there's Dan Aykroyd. He gets to the end of his tether. He picks up a gun. It's like nothing works for him. And he even goes like, that's it. I end it all. And he click.
The gun fails.
Throws the gun down and the gun goes off. And it's like, oh, fuck. I can't even commit suicide. But that's it. It's basically you have to get to that point where you pull the trigger and then basically you must contrive it. So that you absolutely intended the gun to go off, but you even fucked that up. So you kind of deliberately fuck it up. I think Gary understands pretty well how the kind of involution of it.
that's a good word. You're aware that you're caught in this thing that's going like this, you know. Yeah. It's kind of like, you're on this merry-go-round and, you're not, or maybe you're either on it or you're off it. But the point is that the question is, where's the end and where do you break out? You know, how do you get out of it? Stop the thing from going back into another loop all the time, taking you on the same path.
You can't. But you see, what happens after the Dan Aykroyd moment is then you don't give a fuck anymore. It's a great
movie. But there again, but can't you see that the difference with the Dan Aykroyd moment is that it had a serendipitous thing from the outside come in, which was that the gun didn't fucking work. Or
that's the problem. The gun mustn't work.
This is kind of what I'm saying, that it's you can't do this 100% as an endogenous exercise. That you need something to affect it. Greater or lesser degree, something to occur from without, from outside, that you don't know is going to happen. You've got to be tripped up. You can't ever trip yourself up. It's because you're going to know it.
Yes, but you can put yourself on the brink. You see, you're on a very at a very fine point. Again, almost like the pharaohs weighing the. The priest weighing the pharaoh's heart against a feather. You get to a point of sensitivity in this work, with enough work, where you can feel almost like a pendulum inside you. It's almost like a hot rock of sensitivity. I mean, you get acutely sensitized. Now, I think Sophie and Gary, you both know what I'm talking about, because I think you are both acutely sensitized. But then... where that leads you to is a place of very delicate balance. And in that delicate balance, you know, the feather arises and the feather is grace. But you can't ever get there on demand. It's not like going to the gym or basically becoming Arnold Schwarzenegger and getting a gold medal at the Olympics. In fact, it's the, kind of the opposite of that. You have to put in the work as if you get a gold medal and then basically make sure you don't get it. You fall flat on your face. So, yeah.
I was hesitating to use the word grace, but you've used it, so that's okay.
Yeah, so you can't get enlightenment. The more you struggle, the more you practice, the luckier you'll get. Yeah.
Okay. But, yeah, I see that there's a bit of luck involved, as you know, like the fact of the gun not going when you try to kill yourself. So that's luck. And the fact that we are connected and we, you know, we get exposed to ideas and philosophies like you're trying to share with us, that's some sort of luck too. Although, you know, maybe there's a quality in each of us that causes us to seek things out. So it's not entirely an internal thing. Okay. There are outside factors that trigger us to keep.
This is such a difficult subject. I'm really struggling to not mislead you on this. So there really isn't anything like luck. So it's a trick. And generally, a guru wouldn't tell you this. They wouldn't tell you that it's a trick. It's only when you, this is why I'm struggling, because really nobody that hears this must pick up a gun and try to shoot themselves, right? Absolutely forbidden. But I'll give you a hint of what I'm saying, is if you picked up the gun and tried to do it, you would find you would get a Dan Aykroyd moment. It wouldn't go off. And then you would know there's no luck and there's no coincidence. Basically, after realization, it seems absolutely preordained. It seems like there could be no other course. You get a very strong feeling that it was predestined and there was teleology. Part of the reason why we have a taboo against teleology in our culture is because we don't want to get to that moment of epiphany where the alien cortex dies. It basically, if there's no predestiny, then it has room to maneuver. And that's why our culture is hopeful and optimistic and millenarian and futuristic, because it wants room for struggle. It wants to be able to win this chess game. And if you say, like, no, the chess game is predestined, then it gets very upset and has a whole lot of things. Starts getting into these all deep arguments about free will, and, you know, because you've just said, no, alien cortex, you're fucked. You are destined to die. And it's like, oh, I'll be the judge of that. you say, but I'm going to fight my way out. But whichever way the alien cortex fights its way out, when it comes down, when the sword of Damocles comes down on it, then we'll see that there was no other way. There was no other way but the way it unfolded. It couldn't have been any other way. Now, this separates us a lot, because if you're on this side of the looking glass, there's a whole other lexicon and a whole other way of speaking. And then there's things like luck and, you know, teleology is verboten and all this. You've got a head full of crap. But after realization, you realize that it was predestined. There was no way it could be. And you have a strong sense of that. Yeah. So I'm just trying to be truthful about how it is and not trying to be clever. Like most gurus would try not to tell you stuff like that, because it gives you an extra burden, right? You have preconceptions about enlightenment, and then your alien courses will try and cheat. Yeah. See, it's like most gurus won't tell you much about enlightenment, Is it like even Jesus, and people say, well, what about, what's heaven like and stuff? And he says, like, don't fucking ask about heaven. Worry about your life. And a guru also says, like, don't, you know, Zen masters, and he says, don't worry about enlightenment. You know, it's like, yeah, because everybody is a mimic. Like we were talking before about Lucy and the chimp, and people are great mimics. And so if you give them any hints of what enlightenment is like, they will try and mimic that experience. Rather than put in the work to get there, they'll try and fake it, and they'll try and mimic it, or they'll, you know, the enlightenment experience you have can be completely different. For you, it's the only enlightenment experience possible, and it's the only enlightenment experience possible for the universe because it's entirely solipsistic. But for, you know, in truth, everybody has their own epiphany, and if you don't want to screw somebody's epiphany up by telling them what it's like, or by giving them preconceptions, or giving them some target that they try and achieve, because again, it's the opposite. It's when you give up on a target. So I can't tell you how to give up. I say, like, what's giving up like? Well, it feels like, I don't know. You tell me what giving up feels like. But you say, like, oh, you ought to give up. Everything would make sense. The struggle would be over, and you'd be in bonus time. You could start enjoying yourself. And everybody else, the whole world is your problem now. That's the way they set it up. After enlightenment, you're the whole world's problem. You see, it's the old thing, like the old Yiddish thing. It's and like Mr. Panos on this beautiful video of screeching, so like saying, like, yeah, Mr. Panos says, like, everybody says Greece has a problem because Greece owes Germany money. No, you have the problem. If a Greek owes you money, you have the problem. So that's how it is with the whole universe. Is you say, like, oh, you want tax money? Well, you've got a fucking problem because I ain't got any money. You want tax money? You want accounting? You want responsibility? Yeah, I'm out of it. Checked out. I own nothing. I only tell the truth. You, the one with the problem. Say, oh, well, let's work together. It's not, no, fuck you. Work on your own. No, fuck you. You have the problem. That's why the world has a problem with you when you're liberated. That's why it's so expensive to be liberated.
Can we go back just a little bit? There's a couple of things. First was the futile attempt to try and explain what enlightenment is like. And I think the second thing is the question about teleology that you said a little bit before that. I'll do that first because, you've spoken a lot about chronos and kairos and linear thinking, and I'm going to bring in some other things. The way I'm looking at it is that the teleology is nothing special. That's how everything knows about everything else ahead of time and in the past anyway, because time is actually only something that needs to exist because we think. In other words, the alien cortex, which is really just language, thought, sequential processing, can't do that without stretching this out in what it calls time. If you weren't engaged in that process, it would be obvious that everything was just all connected up and going on at the same time. And so teleology would be no surprise, you know, that something that was happening in the past was happening from our point of view in order to make something happen now. And you think, oh, that's a nice arrangement. It's just as well that knew what it was doing ahead of time. But that's just perfectly natural. But we get caught in the linear, looking at everything in terms of, you know, the movement, this, the arrow of time, I guess you could say. I think that might just link up a little bit, because did you or somebody else put up a video of UG Krishnamurti? And he didn't talk about enlightenment. He said, oh, he said, stuff that. He said, it's just the natural state. And that's a very interesting way of getting around this whole thing of sort of objectifying single enlightenment that you set out there in front of yourself to reach as a goal. If you think of it as the natural state, it kind of just lets you rest back into yourself instead of this sort of, because your alien cortex is prone to this sort of reaching out into the future all the time. We're leaning forward into the future, trying to pull it towards, are we waiting to get there? We're impatient, or we're scared of it, or whatever we are. But just forgetting enlightenment as some special thing that I'm going to get to one day, and looking at it in a more restful way, that his words calling it that different name as the natural state was just a very helpful thing in itself.